Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for joining us here this afternoon. We have a very interesting panel discussion coming your way. As you heard the intro there, this was one of the biggest news stories that captivated millions of people around the world. But as always with these news stories, only one outlet can have it first. And we're delighted to be joined by the news outlet that had it first. So Dinara, you might just tell us, before we talk about this particular case, what exactly is Ruplee, for those who don't know? What is it that you do?
Okay, so Ruplee is a news video agency that operates 24/7, and we are specializing in break news stories, in live streaming from breaking news stories and hardly accessible places. We also provide video news feed to our clients and different viral stories. And we are pioneering in different technology of digital delivery of the products. For example, our live platform that allows people and individuals and big companies to stream our live streams with just two clicks to any social media page. Also, we stands for democratization of video content. So we make our content accessible not only for big media networks, but also for individuals and emerging media.
And how long have you been doing this? Because for those of us who are, you know, I work in a newsroom, but I work in a radio newsroom. For those who are consumers of news, we've had the 24-hour news channels for quite a while, but getting video content on social media platforms is still kind of relatively new. So how long have you guys been in operation?
So we are only 7 years old.
Okay.
And from the very beginning, we understood, like, we are relatively small agency. And from one side, our competitors are such giants as AFP, AP, and Reuters. And on the other side, we wanted to find a niche where we could be the first ones. So from the very beginning, we started developing those technologies to be digitally successful.
One of the most important things that comes with streaming, putting video content out there, is ensuring that what you are putting out is accurate. It is what you're saying it is, and that it's not sort of in breach of someone's privacy or anything like that. So how do you go about ensuring that what you're putting out there is as it should be?
Oh, yes, this is a very important question because, of course, when you work in news industry, it's all about speed. It's all about getting videos first. It's a lot of pressure. And, of course, everyone does mistakes, and we did many mistakes in the beginning. So we developed the whole system of video verification, which applies to video that comes from our own contributors as well as the user-generated content. And we use about 5 to 6 programs at the same time to verify geographic location, time, and who this video is done by, so that we secure, like, we don't put out video until we are really sure that this is a verified footage. And we actually established our verification unit, and we put out educational video about very interesting cases that we managed to verify. For example, the construction of a wall by Turkey in northern Syria, we verified that footage. Or just recently, we verified the rare drone footage of the place where al-Baghdadi was supposedly killed.
Okay.
So things like that, we are doing these educational videos and put them out so people can see how we do that and maybe later do it themselves. And we launch an educational program where we basically give all our tools and explain people how they can use it as well. We strongly believe in literacy and that it's very important to be open about that and to basically share our success with people.
We're going to watch a video that you have in just a second, but before we see that, how do you balance the verification process with the need for speed? Because as I said, you know, with these things, there can only be one first. And as we have so many different news outlets, we have citizen journalism, Every fool has a phone. So how do you make sure that you are verifying, but also still first?
You know, sometimes we need to choose.
Okay.
And if we choose, we of course choose to verify rather than to be first. But of course, speed matters a lot. That's why our journalists are always very speedy. They have very light equipment. They can go live from anywhere they are. But also, if it's user-generated content, then we have basically scouters, people who look for interesting video, and then people who verify that.
Okay, so do you want to tell us a little bit about the first video that you're going to show us here now?
Verification
yes.
unit video. Yes, yes, please. Can we just play that?
Can we play the video?
This is our presentation of the verification unit.
Verification is our push for accuracy. To continue to provide trusted, verified news content to our clients and their audiences around the globe. Fact-checking and validation is at our core. We filter inaccurate online information and get the facts right. Trust is not deserved. Trust is earned.
The concept there at the end, trust is earned. How damaging can it be to a news brand or to any form of outlet if they do put something out there that is not authentic or verified?
Of course, there is such amount of information now that sometimes mistakes are inevitable. But I think we all should learn by our mistakes and not to make it the second times. And of course, I think use your brains, use your investigative skills to and maybe intuition to kind of feel, do we need to go there or not? Or it's too kind of weird.
So we're going to talk now about the Julian Assange video. And Juan, we're going to come to you in a second. But tell us how you guys came to be first. Was it a strategic operation? Was it the collusion, which some people suggested, or was it just pure luck?
It's not only that we were the first ones to film Julian Assange's arrest, but we were the only ones, basically. And one of the reasons for that was that one of our products is live streaming. So when something happens, we are there and we are doing hours of live streaming. So one of these examples is the protest of Gilets Jaunes in France. And we just got Shorty Awards for that, for the hours of live streaming of the protest. And one, like another case was Julian Assange. When WikiLeaks just tweeted about the fact that this arrest is imminent, we deployed 5 people to London. Again, we are not a big agency, so we had 2 people there, 2 staffers, and we needed to send 3 more people. And we started doing live there for 5 days. So we streamed protests that were happening outside the embassy and people who came to cheer Julian up and like that. And then at some point, there were other media as well, but at some point, they decided that nothing was happening and they left. And we didn't leave, we stayed. And it just started happening. And we apparently, not apparently, but eventually we became the only media who got this historical moment. And this video was taken by about 200 media outlets from 50 countries.
Wow.
Yeah. And I just want to quote, if I can, what how our producer described that moment when she was standing outside the embassy. As the street was almost empty and the police came in really suddenly and without big movement or alarm, I even thought they were only going to perform some kind of a drill. It seemed like just another common day. I remained calm and concentrated in getting the image. But while it was happening, as I saw him being carried out, shouting, you came, must resist, it turned real to me and clear that the police was indeed arresting Julian, and we were the only media to catch those images.
It's incredible, and it is, as you say, just your perseverance with not going home when everyone else went home. I wonder if I can bring you in here. So how does an organization like WikiLeaks use the new form of journalism such as this, not necessarily to its advantage, but utilize it, I suppose?
I think there is a common origin, which is the fact that large flows of data can be now broadcasted by organizations with little to no means. In the case of WikiLeaks, almost no one. You have maybe much more means, but the idea is the same, is that the weight of data can now be treated by small organizations, whereas before it needed a huge infrastructure. I mean, and then there is the, we're stuck in this geopolitical era in which basically Russia learned from the United States and learned that using tools which are called of democratization of or abroad their regional sphere could help them influence and gain influence into and power outside. And so it's exactly what the US have done in the 80s. And now Russia is copying that model in order to try to spread its influence. And therefore we have actors like Russia Today and Reply that paradoxically become locally allies of people who are fighting for democracy was still belonging to an authoritarian state, which is extremely violent against its own population on those matters. And this paradox is very complicated to deal with when you're an actor of the political game, because you have to make a compromise or not. You have to decide whether to go along or not, if you can. In the cases of Yellow Jackets, for example, they just accepted to be filmed by anyone present. And it was extremely important to have all these media which were not linked to the elites of France, because the elites of France were basically trying to suppress the protest at any cost. There was like a real fear that something coming from the grassroots would threaten the equilibrium of the country. And the only way out was social networks which belonged to the US, or independent media, or dependent media from other political spheres like Reply and Russia Today. And so we were still powerless in the sense that we didn't have our own media and our own ways of diffusing our ideas, but we still could play on different actors and play on the concurrence that they have between each other to try to convey our messages. And of course, the images of Julian Assange, for example, it was critical to see the body of Julian Assange being dragged out of the embassy and to see in which state he was. And if we hadn't had these images, and I come back to WikiLeaks now, it would have been much more difficult to make the people understand the violence of what he was suffering for 8 years and that he still suffers today. I remember that he's shortly in a prison in London for having revealed the 2011 cables of the US, which revealed, 2010 and 2011, sorry, which revealed massive crimes against humanity and war crimes committed by the US in Iraq and Afghanistan. And we have Tony Blair like giving a speech here, he triggered the war, and we have Julian Assange, who's a journalist, who only revealed the truth about this war, who is in a prison in Belmarsh in London. And so being able to, just give citizens who often feel powerless the capacity to see that this is happening, and therefore maybe to have a reaction, and even if it's only emotional at first, to have an impulsion that then maybe will trigger action, it's extremely, extremely important for us. And whatever it comes from, in these situations, as you said, 200 media outlets took it afterwards. They didn't care where it came from. And this also comes to another problematic that WikiLeaks has. WikiLeaks was very criticized for having published the documents regarding Hillary Clinton in 2016. But reality is that the huge effect that these documents had was produced by media. Mm. It was the other media who seized on those documents and triggered this. And they didn't have the responsibility of publishing them first, but then they used and abused of it. And probably, and I will end up on that, there was in the last intervention of Barack Obama, when leaving the White House, he gave a last press conference in January 2017, and he was asked about the case. And he basically said, and I push you to watch the video, he basically said, okay, WikiLeaks did its job. It had interesting documents it published. He didn't say interesting documents. It had documents and he published it. But then, and he was telling the journalists, you have to ask yourselves, about why did you get into such a race for buzz and for excitation? Why did you create such a bubble around those documents? You're the ones who created this bubble. And this, of course, was never a question that was asked by the media themselves, because it would bring them to their own responsibility on the process. There is something which is producing raw documents, raw footage, and roughly, if I understand correctly, there is never comments on the images, no, if I'm right, which is not a way to... That doesn't mean that there is no perspective put on the issues, but, I mean, they're used as raw documents by media then to feed their own...
But that's what I want to ask, because we have more news outlets than we've ever had before. There are so many people, but now, if you look in the US as an example, you kind of know the angle that each news outlet is going to take. Is there an argument for just putting raw material out there, having people like Rupley just putting raw footage out there and then letting commentary come on top of that?
I'll just contradict myself shortly by saying that there is never raw material. A material is always, in the way it's chosen, selected, and put live, it's always chosen. You have an agenda, which is to cover demonstrations, which is to cover everything that will show the existence of dissensus in the world, and especially in the Western world, to show that every society has contradictions. I guess it's why you were partly created. And so even if you don't show society as a whole in permanence. So that is, even that.
Yeah.
And we shouldn't be, there isn't, neutrality doesn't exist. In the moment you create content, you're not neutral. Whatever content it is, however you're
created. We believe that raw footage, like bringing raw footage, is very important. And then the more raw footage exists from different places, the more people can make their own decisions about what's happening. So we produce raw footage. We try to make it live as much as possible. People can see it and make their own decisions and make their own conclusions. Yeah.
We have less than 1 minute left. I want to ask a quick question about deep fake videos. We've seen quite a lot of this now. Is that going to mess up the verification process when we have technology almost trying to undermine other technology?
We should advance, like the industry should advance as it goes. So it's not like, okay, we are so good in verification and we should stop and we have our technology. But it's about something that is developing every single day. So we should be thinking, we should be smart, we should be thinking about where this can come from and what we should do to prevent the misinformation.
Okay, it's a conversation that could go on, and we'll come back, I'd say, in a few months' time. But unfortunately, that is all we have time for. So my thanks to Dinara and Juan. Enjoy the rest of Web Summit. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.